to measure and record our wealth is one of the oldest human impulses. We were accounting before we could use abstract numbers. We were accounting before we could write. It now appears that writing, one of the greatest human accomplishments, was invented by accountants. In 1969, the French archaeologist Denish began a research project. She found small pieces of clay that other researchers had overlooked. Among figurines, pots and mud bricks, she also found fired clay tokens which were shaped as cones, spheres and cylinders. As she grouped the tokens together, she began to realize she had at her fingertips the remains of an ancient counting system. The earliest tokens date back to around 7000 BC when settled farming communities first appeared in Mesopotamia and people began to keep track of their produce and exchanges. Each shape represented a different thing. A cone was a small measure of grain, a sphere was a large measure of grain, and a cylinder was an animal. This simple token accounting method was our first symbol system created solely for communicating. It was our first visual code and the first technology invented for storing memory. So the first method of accounting was token-based accounting. As cities emerged and with them bronzemiths, potter's wheel, merchants and large-scale trade also increased. So the tokens suddenly changed. A complex accounting system emerged. Now there were 100 token shapes to record a wide range of goods, including bread, honey, textiles and metal. And the accountants began to store their tokens in hollow clay balls or envelopes, imprinted with the signature seal of the parties involved in the exchange. Total sum of tokens inside a clay envelope recorded an individual's assets, and therefore putting a token into the envelope increased the owner's assets, which is equivalent of a debit entry. Taking a token out of an envelope reduced the owner's assets and was thus the same as a credit entry. The ancient accountants then began to press the tokens into the wet clay of the envelope, recording on its surface the number and sort of tokens it contained, and in the process took the first step towards inventing writing. So the invention of token accounting in Mesopotamia was important not only because it facilitated economic exchanges and generated writing, but because it encouraged people to see the world around them in terms of quantifiable outcomes. For the first time, we had tools which allowed us to count and measure, to quantify the world around us and to record our findings. The token-based accounting provided the pathway for double entry. Early medieval merchants were little more than traveling salesmen. They had no need to keep accounts. They could simply check whether their purse was full or empty. But as the commercial enterprises of the Italian city-states grew larger and became more dependent on financial instruments such as loans and currency trades, the need for more careful accounting became clear. To illustrate the need for accounting, we had a remarkable record of the business affairs of Datini, a merchant near Florence who kept accounts for nearly half a century, from 1366 to 1400. He began as little more than a financial diary, but as his business grew more complex, he needed something more sophisticated. Datini's meticulously kept account books span for almost 50 years and clearly show the transition from single to double entry bookkeeping. Fortunately, he had been using bookkeeping for more than a decade, so was able to keep track of his extraordinarily intricate web of transactions. After the death of Datini in 1400, the Venetians had abandoned the Roman system of writing numbers and were instead embracing Hindu-Arabic numerals. The use of Hindu-Arabic numerals was advocated by the man who codified the art of bookkeeping practices of Venice. By the 1430s, the merchants of Venice had perfected a system of double-entry account keeping in two columns. The man responsible for its codification and preservation, the author of world's first printed bookkeeping treatise, is Luca di Pacioli, the father of double-entry bookkeeping in the 1440s. Fasioli defines double-entry bookkeeping as the expression in writing of arrangement of merchants' affairs. If a merchant follows the system Fasioli sets out, he will always know all about his business and will know exactly whether his business goes well or not. Double-entry bookkeeping was slow to catch on, perhaps because it was technically demanding and unnecessary for simple businesses. But after Fasioli, it was always regarded as the pinnacle of art. As a first thing, according to Fasioli, a merchant must make an inventory of everything he owns. A merchant must always put down on a sheet of paper or in a separate book whatever he has, be it personal property, real estate, bringing with the things that are most valuable and most likely to be lost, such as cash, silver, etc. Inventory is a record of business stock holding as of a particular date or time period. Once the inventory is made, Fasioli specifies that a merchant needs three books in which he needs to record his business transactions. The first is memorandum, which acted like a diary and was also known as a waste book because it is a temporary record of the merchant's day-to-day transactions. The second book is journal. After entering the inventory into the journal, the merchant uses this book to write up in a neat and orderly fashion the details of each transaction that has been recorded in the memorandum. In Fasioli's system, every item entered into the journal must be preceded by one of the two keywords, per, which means from, and indicated that the ledger account must be debited, and to, which means that the ledger account must be credited. No item is ever entered in the journal unless it is preceded by one of these two expressions. The two entries are entered together one after the other on the same line, separated from each other with two little slanting parallel lines. The third book that has to be maintained by the merchant, according to Fasioli, is the ledger. The ledger is made up of pages rolled into two columns, the simplest form of which is known as a T-column. For every entry made in the journal, there will be two in the ledger. One, a debit entered on the left-hand side of the T column, and other, a credit on the right. The ledger with its two columns marked a great advance in account keeping. By using this system, the merchant could at any moment see at glance the precise state of his assets and debts. It also allowed him to find mistakes in his bookkeeping relatively easily, because if his books did not balance, if his debits were not equal to his credits, he made a mistake somewhere and would have to scrutinize his books to find it. The ledger with its double entries was an innovation made by the merchants of Venice, and is the reason that Venetian bookkeeping is now known as a double entry. Bookkeeping Italian style appealed to teachers and busy merchants because it was such a methodical and orderly system, and the records it kept were so comprehensive. Because of this, double entry became associated with good bookkeeping. The notion of good bookkeeping was soon extended to the point that the use of double entry was seen to confer moral legitimacy on a merchant's work. The profit figures that Fasioli's double entry made it possible to calculate was a vital tool for early merchants, used in their decision making, forecasting and planning. The Industrial Revolution and rise of new forms of business organization known as joint stock company, double entry proved remarkably adaptable to each new demand. It was during the Industrial Revolution that double entry bookkeeping became seen not just as an exercise for mathematical perfectionists, but also as a tool to guide practical business decisions. One of the first to see this was Wedgwood, the pottery entrepreneur. At first, Wedgwood had good margins that he didn't bother to have detailed accounts. But in 1772, Europe faced a severe recession and demand for Wedgwood's crockery collapsed. His warehouses began to fill with unsold stock and workers stood idle. Wedgwood turned to double entry bookkeeping to understand where in his business the profits were and how to expand them. During this period of scrutiny, Wedgwood made an important discovery, the distinction between fixed and variable cost, and he immediately understood the implications of their difference for the management of his business. This was one of the earliest instances of the use of double entry bookkeeping to analyze business accounts and apply the financial information thus extracted to guide business strategy and decision making in the new industrial world. As time passed, Accounting also had another role to play. It's about ensuring that shareholders in a business receive a fair share of corporate profits, when only the accountants can say what these profits really are. The power of calculating the difference between capital and income is one of the basic characteristics of double entry bookkeeping, and the need to make this distinction in order to calculate dividends became one of the driving forces behind the international adoption of double entry bookkeeping.
Do subscribe to Smart Rules for more interesting videos in accounting and finance.